these concentrated foods that are so harmful to us give us so much pleasure? Dr. Lyle says the answer is related to a system called the motivational triad. This is a trio of biological mechanisms that nature has designed into every creature on Earth so they can survive to pass their genes on to the next generation. The first leg of the motivational triad is pleasure seeking.
And primarily two things are the cause of that, and those two things are food and sex. So in the case of a great white shark, it's basically got a neon sign flashing across its forehead saying food, sex, food, sex, food, sex. Unless it's a male, then it says sex, food, but it's pretty much the same thing.
The other two legs of the motivational triad are avoiding pain and doing everything with the least amount of effort.
Pleasure-seeking, pain avoidance, and energy conservation, that really sums up animal behavior, whether we're talking about a paramecium under a microscope or a great white shark.
Richer foods naturally excite our senses because it's nature's way of telling us they will provide the highest amount of dietary reward with the least amount of effort. This helped our ancestors find the most calorie-dense and ripe foods available, which contributed to our survival. But in today's environment, we can artificially increase calorie density well beyond what our ancestors would have found in nature. The resulting foods give us a hyper-normal amount of pleasure, leading us into something Dr. Lyle calls the pleasure trap.
What the pleasure trap is an interaction between our natural instincts, which are trying to tell us the right thing to do, and some kind of artificial modern stimulation that is piggybacking or hijacking that process. So the classic example of the pleasure trap would be drugs and drug addiction. The way drugs work is they hijack the existing pleasure circuits. When certain chemicals hit those areas, they cause feelings of euphoria and excitement.
The same drug-like effect happens when we eat highly concentrated, processed foods.
We've removed the fiber, we've removed the water, we've removed the minerals, we've done everything that we can to hyper-concentrate sugar and fat and add a bunch of salt as well into the food. And now what the food has become is become a low-grade addiction.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Doug Lyle.
Thank you. Thank you. Truly, truly a pleasure to be here. I'm really happy to be here with you folks today. What we're going to talk about today is something that is actually the number one New Year's resolution in the United States. This would have been unheard of 50 years ago, but today we all know what it is, which is weight loss. So everybody's now, as the end of the year came and they looked at January 1st rolling around, they thought, okay, you know, is this, you know, I really need to do this. I'm frustrated with myself. I'm frustrated with my body. I'm worried about my long-term health. I need to do something about this. And people have thought about it before, and almost anybody that is trying to get in better physical condition, to get healthier, to get trimmer, and to feel better about themselves, almost anybody that has tried to do this has tried to do it many times. They've had many attempts at this. They've had some moderate successes led by relapse and failure and frustration. And so what we're going to do today is we're going to try to figure out the solution to the mystery of why it is that this is so difficult to do, what is it that needs to be done, and where you need to point your compass, so what road you need to walk to make this a reality. One of the things that happens is that people believe that they already know the answer as to why it is that they need to lose, or how it is that they're going to lose weight. They believe that they already know, and they think that the solution is actually quite simple. They think that they need to eat less food and they need to exercise more. If they do those two things, then they will lose weight. And I can tell you that if that is what you've tried to do, then you have lost your mind whenever that has happened. Because what happened is you wind up with a ferocious hunger drive, great frustration, and this becomes nothing other than an exercise in supreme willpower. And that's not going to work. You were not designed to have this problem. This is an unnatural problem. And it's going to require for us to actually understand it to remove the obstacles. Today's talk is called Losing Weight Without Losing Your Mind. And it is very possible to do. It can be done. I've successfully helped people, and so many other of my colleagues have helped people do this very effectively over the years. You don't need to be doing what everybody thinks you need to be doing. which is to what I call eat under the hunger drive. You do not have to eat less. You don't have to push yourself away from the table. You don't have to frustrate yourself and consider yourself that you did a good job today if you didn't eat very much. If you didn't eat very much today and you thought you just did a good job, I will tell you, you just made a big mistake. You just set yourself up for failure tomorrow. I want people to be very comfortable about how it is that they go about this process of losing weight. There are challenges involved here, but we can meet those challenges and you can accomplish what you want to accomplish without great stress and strain. Now, you might look up here and you might say what my dad said. Doug, the last thing people want to do is hear about weight loss from a borderline anorexic. It just so happens that I was built this way. We'll learn a little bit more about that as we go along. Most people were not built with extremely slender genes the way that I was, but that doesn't mean that we can't identify principles that will work for everyone. We can. All right, so here we go. Start here. Everybody knows, of course, what this is. Doesn't look like a penguin to me. Of course it's a bird. That was never in doubt. Of course it's a chicken, ma'am. That was never in doubt. And this is the great question that we need to start this talk with. It's the second greatest philosophical question of all time. And that is... Why does a chicken cross the road? To get to the other side, of course. Why does a chicken need to get to the other side? Just to see what's there. Well, let's now just start thinking about this. Why would it want to get to the other side? There's things going on over there that might be worth doing. There might be more worms over there. So it might have a suspicion that there might be more worms over there. Or there might be... There we go. So, and we see that there might be another sort of biological profit there. Somewhere in here, there's biological profit. There might be a third reason, and that is, I'm not really sure what that animal is, but it's a dangerous-looking thing. So, what we're going to see is that there's going to be reasons why the chicken crosses the road. It's always been a sort of funny little ancient question for human beings to look at, because it doesn't look like there's any reason why the chicken is crossing the road. It looks like a bunch of random, you know, gibberish is happening. But that's not what's happening. That chicken is actually running very sophisticated mathematical algorithms. That little thing is actually trying to figure out how its next best move is going to statistically increase the likelihood of its genes being on the planet 100 years from now. It has no idea that that's why it's doing what it's doing, but believe me, that is why it's doing what it's doing. And the decisions it's making are not random. It has some reason to believe there might be better, easier food over there. Maybe it's hearing other chickens over there very clucking excitedly about the food. It could be that it can smell it. It could be that it's known that the feeding that it's doing over on here on this side of the road seems a little depleted. It's not getting very many little bugs per square yard, and it feels like it wants to take a chance on some new territory. It could also be smelling pheromones, and it's going to head over there for possible mating activity. This thing is designed, or it could be escaping a predator. It's running as fast as it can to get across that road. So in other words, we don't know why it's doing what it's doing, but it's doing it for a reason. Whenever you see a twitch of a whisker on anything in nature, there's a reason why that happened, and the reason is ultimately built into the motivational triad. So... what's happening is that chicken is pleasure-seeking, it's potentially avoiding pain, in the predator case, or it's trying to conserve energy. What it's after is the motivational triad, as we talked about earlier today. And that's why creatures do things. That's why predators go after the weak. That's why fish swim in school. That's why people try to fight for parking places in front of the health club. This is why things happen. And these, of course, the infamous Canadian geese. We know why they do what they do. Now, one of the things that's interesting about the weight problem is, it's funny, I've heard all kinds of different numbers, and all the numbers are all haywire and nobody knows the truth. But it turns out the latest estimate of species on the planet are there's 20 million. You know, a few years ago when I was making these slides, it was 2 million. Who knows? Okay, so I don't really care because it's off, but here's my point. There are three species on this planet currently that are having problems with their weight. Three. What are they?
Dogs,
cats, human beings. They all live in human houses. Now, isn't this just a little bit suspicious? So when you start hearing about all the wacky reasons why you think you have weight problems that they talked about on Oprah or they talk in some shrink's office, I want you to back the camera up and look at all of nature and think to yourself, there's three species that are having the problem. Three, not one, it's three. And all of them live in the same place. And the reason is obviously their dietary behavior, and it's human dietary behavior, the concentration of calories that we then feed some of our animals, and some of those animals are going to wind up in the same pleasure trap that we have. I have a cat at home named Boo, and Boo was raised and born and raised on vegan food, and so she's been eating vegan food now for, I don't know, about a year now. And slender and healthy and all this sort of thing. And about, I ran out of the vegan food about a month ago. And so I got her the best thing that I could get easily at the store before I could get myself organized and get her another sack of the vegan food. So I got her, of course, very spoiled cat. I don't have any children of my own, so I got her Newman's, you know, sack of Newman's healthy cat food. And boy, does she like that Newman's. And the kids tell me that that Boo is now a little bigger than Boo was a month ago. And so then I said, wait a minute, I don't want Boo to have a problem here, and I'm going to get on the line and order that food. So I did. And so I brought in the nice, healthy vegan food again, and Boo doesn't want to eat the vegan food. She doesn't know who she's dealing with. All right. So we got three species in trouble, and we're one of them. So what we're not going to see is the solution for birds having a problem. Birds aren't having a problem. But I suppose if they did, and they were to go on Oprah, or they were going to talk to various assorted experts, they might think that what they need to do is to eat less worms and do more exercise. That's what might happen. But guess what? We don't have any birds with that problem, so I'm not understanding why we don't have birds waddling around with a problem. There's plenty of food out there, by the way, and when you look at animals in natural habitats where there's plenty of food, they do not get overweight. So even though I've heard discussion among very learned, very bright people in the last 20 years looking at this problem, one of the arguments that they will make is that they will say the problem is we don't exercise enough and we don't have to work hard enough for our food, and there's plenty of food around where there used to be deprivation, so therefore people are just eating too much food. Ladies and gentlemen, that is nonsense. All you have to do is watch animals in their natural habitat where there is plenty of food. If there is a great deal of food in the environment, the animals do not get fat. What do you think happens when there's a lot of food in the environment that it is not hard to get to? They reproduce more. That's what they're designed to do. They are here as gene reproduction devices. And so as a result, if they don't have to work as hard to get their food, they are going to default then to the important biological job of reproducing genes, which is exactly what they do. So they don't wind up, you don't wind up with big, you know, overweight crocodiles, you wind up with more crocodiles. So there's something wrong with what we're seeing with our special three species that doesn't have to do with the fact that the food is plentiful or that they don't have to work that hard for it. That's not what's happening. Something else is happening, and we're going to find what the root of that problem is. Now it's going to turn out that the slender people have absolutely no idea what's going on, but they're all experts. They all think they know. The slender people believe that if you have a weight problem, they believe that the reason why you have a weight problem is because you're eating too much food and you're not exercising enough. They think that they exercise willpower, that they could have eaten more at dinner, but they chose to push themselves away from the table before that day, and they could have eaten 3 or 4 or 5 more bites, but they decided not to. And that's the reason why they don't have a weight problem, and that's the reason why you do. They believe this. The reason why they believe it is that it makes intuitive sense. They're saying, well, I'm doing okay. If you're having a weight problem, you must be self-indulgent. It must be the case. And they're also thinking something else. Everybody here has done what I call eat into the pain. Eating into the pain is once you've had plenty of food to eat, you're completely satiated. However, there's some really rich treat there, and you can cram that thing in. You take one bite of it, and you're thinking, well, now I'm getting just a little bit of pain, but that's okay. The pleasure is worth it. And you take another bite, and you're like, well, it's a little bit more pain, but the pleasure is still worth it. You take another bite, it's still worth it. Finally, you reach a time when you've now habituated to the pleasure, and you're starting to get more pain, and you say, okay, that's enough. I've had that moment where I had one too many swallows, and it was like that one was a mistake. We've all eaten into the pain. A slender person looks at people with weight problems and says, you must be eating into the pain all the time. Because I eat into the pain once in a while, and I don't have a weight problem, so you must be doing it all the time. So the slender people are walking around mystified, wondering what is wrong with everybody struggling with their weight. Why don't they just push themselves away from the table? It has absolutely led to a witch hunt, looking for the reasons for this bizarre self-indulgence, and this is what we come up with. People think that the reason why people have weight problems, if we get an expert on TV or we have some actress that we're going to ask her opinion about why it is that she stays thin, we're going to hear all kinds of things from people. Well, I do portion control. Yeah, well, we're going to find out how senseless that is. Lack of exercise is the problem. Too much stress, okay? Emotional eating, genes, fast food, too much snacking, childhood issues. Now, childhood issues. See now. We've got areas of the world where people are getting enough to eat. We got places where there's 2 billion people in Asia, and apparently none of them have childhood issues, because not a single one of them is fat. Those parents over there are incredible. They never step on anybody's little self-esteem toes. Yet in the United States, apparently 70 to 80% of the parents are just butchering the psychologies of their children, since 7 or 8 out of 10 kids is going to wind up with a weight problem. Okay? The only thing is, it's a little weirder than that. Because over there in Asia, the cats and the dogs aren't having a weight problem either. But over in America, we must be mistreating our animals, or we're putting the lid up and down on the kitty litter box a little too early or a little too late. There's something deep psychologically wrong with how we're raising our kittens, because they wind up with this problem. Okay. The problem is not psychological. Weight problems are not psychological. Weight problems cause psychological problems. That's a whole different story. We have reverse cause and effect here, and the reversal of that cause and effect is tricky for people to understand. Sometimes it's very hard to know, you know, which comes first, the chicken or the egg. It's very difficult to figure that out. So it's difficult for people in the midst of battling a weight problem to try to figure out, well, why am I having this problem? What is going on? Where did this start? How did this happen? And so, of course, they're going to look for psychological reasons why this must have happened, but they're looking in the wrong place. the weight problem is causing psychological turmoil. It causes a great deal of turmoil. Okay, it causes social prices to be paid, romantic prices to be paid, self-esteem, prejudice in the workplace. It causes all kinds of has all these kinds of ancillary problems that result from this, and it's rough. And so, of course, people then, in the midst of that analysis, start thinking that maybe this problem is psychological, but it's not. Here we have Frisky. I once lived with two cats. One of them looked like this. Kind of had my genes. Then there was one that looked like that. Spot. Cleverly named. And it turns out that when I'd eat them, or excuse me, I didn't eat them, sorry. AJ, you just enjoyed that just a little too much. When I fed them, this is what I would see, their little smiling faces looking up at me. And one of them looked like that, and the other one looked like that. And yet, they were feeding out of exactly the same bowl. There's the artist. Now, that's important for us to understand. Like, in the United States, people are all pretty much eating the same food. If you look at any major analysis of what people are eating, the slender people, the slenderest people you know, maybe not you because you're an unusual group that has ties with a hyper-health-oriented community. But if you were a little more normal and weren't out in the whack end of the continuum here, if you had a friend, one of them that was thin and one of them that had a weight problem, those two people would be eating essentially the same food. Their food choices aren't any different. We've got maybe 10, 15% of the United States. We've got 30 or 40 million people that don't have weight problems. Let me tell you something. Those 30 or 40 million people, they're eating the same thing everybody else is eating. They're eating the same French fries, same hamburgers, same cheeseburgers, same ice cream. They're eating the same chips. They're eating all of the same things. Okay? They're both eating out of the same food bowl. One of them has a weight problem. One of them doesn't. We're going to try to figure out what the answer is. Why is it happening that some people and some cats and some dogs are having a problem? Here's where it starts. Everybody knows who this is, of course. It's Isaac Newton. Okay? Here's Isaac here. And he's sitting under an apple tree, and the apple drops and hits him on the head. And he says, I've got it. The moon is not falling to the earth, but the apple fell on the earth and it's accelerated down at whatever it is. We got the inverse square law. Okay, hold on a second. Before I get this all figured out, I'm going to have to invent differential and integral calculus and some little hassles like that. But no problem. By the time I'm 24, I got it all mapped out. And what he winds up with is the law of gravity. We have something else that's just as universal. You're going to see it all over the animal kingdom. It's the law of satiety. Law of satiety is that animals eating to full satisfaction or satiety in their natural habitat will, over time, neither eat too much or too little for optimum health. They're not going to do that. You've got millions of species out there. They're not having any problem. You've got trillions of individuals of those species. They're not having any problem. We're only having a few isolated little pockets in the world of a few little species that are having a problem. That's because something is not happening, and it cannot be that the law of satiety is being violated, because the law of satiety is a natural law. It's just how it works. So what's happening here? So there's some, just like when you see a rocket ship go up, you're not seeing a violation of the law of gravity or a hot air balloon. You're just seeing a set of forces here that winds up acting against each other, and then we get something that's curious. The same thing is happening when it comes to satiety. Here's a math problem. 45 years, so I'm a little older than that now, I've eaten about, about 3 or 4 pounds of food a day, 1,000 pounds a year, 45,000 pounds more or less. Now, I know I don't look like it, but that's how it is. Eating about that much food. Now, if I were just 1% short, what would that mean? If I was 1% short, that means I would have been 450 pounds of food short by now. And if I was 450 pounds of food short, I would have had to cannibalize that food out of my own tissue, which means I'd be a dead duck. There's no way I could have survived that. So I could not have survived eating 1% less food than I needed. If I ate 1% too much food, then I would have eaten 450 pounds of food too much, which means I would have stored quite a bit of fat on me. I might have 30 or 40 or 50 extra pounds of fat. Now that seems reasonable. So now what we're going to look at is we're going to look at data, for example, that takes the average woman in the United States between the ages of 20 and 40, and over that period of time, the average woman gains 1 pound a year. That means 1 pound a year is, call it 3,500 calories a year. Over 365 days, it's about 10 calories a day. Nip by nip by nip by nip by nip. It's like a little drop on a rock. It's just gently taking place where the person is systematically overeating. They are not massively overeating. They are not completely out of control. The laws of satiety are working as hard as it can on this creature to try to make sure that it eats the right amount of food, but it's missing a little bit, and it's missing always on the high side for some people, and in fact, most people. The reason why this is happening, we're going to look at now, but we're going to now see how it is that you could possibly engineer a creature to be so close to perfect. Because throughout the world, they aren't 1% off, they're perfect. You look at the gazelles, look at the crocodiles, look at the llamas, look at the cheetahs, they've all got it just right. None of these things are walking around 20 or 30 or 40% overweight, none of them. And as long as there's food, they're not starving to death. They're within very, very narrow targets of perfection, just as human beings are supposed to do. So if we have a mistake, those mistakes aren't large. They can be very, very small, but they are inexorable. In other words, you cannot seem to stop them. You can't seem to keep pushing yourself away from the table with self-discipline. That does not seem to be the answer. The reason is that these are unconscious processes, and they are engineered or they're administrated through an area of the brain called the hypothalamus. The hypothalamus does an awful lot of regulating in the body. So, for example, it's regulating your fluid intake so that you get thirsty if you get a little bit low on fluid, and then you get satiated as soon as you've had enough. It's going to regulate your sleep. So if you're short of sleep, you feel it, and then you feel a pressure in order to sleep. If you get cold or too hot, you feel like moving to an area that's better. In other words, you're constantly moving and adjusting to try to put yourself in idealized circumstances for survival. The same thing is going to happen with food. There's no reason why this shouldn't work perfectly. Each and every one of you in here, every single one of you, has a perfectly functioning satiety mechanism. There's nothing wrong with it. Okay? Some of you are having more weight problems than others. Some of you aren't having any weight problems. The reasons we're about to look at. The satiety mechanism in the hypothalamus is going to be sensitive to inputs from the digestive system. And there's going to be many mechanisms. I'm just going to look at one example of how this can, how these problems can be generated. You have both in your digestive system, both nutrient receptors and stretch receptors. So your stomach is designed by nature to cause you to tell you to stop eating when it's been stretched out, when the receptors are getting evidence that there's no reason to put any more in there, that we've got about as much as we can handle. And so that's a primary method by, short-term method by when most animals, including people, say that they've had enough. If you put more in there, it starts to get them into pain. So that's a regulating system to help us eat about the right amount of food. But that's not enough. Because if you were only designed by nature just to be paying attention to stretch receptors, then we could simply fill your stomach with a bunch of lettuce, and we could put a pound of lettuce in there, which would only be about 100 calories, and you would feel fully satiated. And yet, if we did that 3 or 4 times a day, which is about what you're designed to do, is eat about 3 to 5 pounds of food a day, if we did that, you'd only eat 300 or 400 or 500 calories, and you would starve to death, because you cannot survive on that. So the nervous system cannot simply depend on stretch reception because it's not adequately reliable. You need to actually have another system, and that system is going to be nutrient reception. So your digestive system can detect fat, sugar, and protein. You can actually find out and count how much of each of those things that you put in there. So they can actually figure out, all things considered, about how many calories did we eat. And that's how that's going to work. So you've got different kinds of receptors in there doing its best to say, how many, you know, of this food that you just put in there, how much of the fat did I get, how much of the carbohydrate, how much protein, how much of this is just fiber. And so all together, it works together as a counting system, or as an accounting system, to try to tell you when it is that you should stop eating and when you need to continue. Now, so this is what they are. They're just a calorie estimation system with stretch receptions to tell you sort of by volume that you've had about enough. But then the nutrient receptors are actually a little more sophisticated, trying to give you an accurate count. Obviously, if you ate a bunch of lettuce and a slice of bread, then it could say, okay, well, that slice of bread is a lot more concentrated than just the lettuce, so we've got to give you more credit for how much is that you just ate, so that we don't want to overeat. Okay, so this is all how this thing is being balanced. Now, it all sounds great, except now we're going to look at two people, one of them that doesn't have a weight problem and one of them that does. And we're going to now look here, and we're going to see that this guy here, who has a really cool goatee, by the way, this guy has a bunch of stretch receptors, and he's got fat receptors, for example, in his stomach. And this guy has stretch receptors, and he has fat receptors in his stomach. So far, so good. Everybody's on an even playing field, but we've got a mystery here about why one of them is having a weight problem and one of them isn't. Now what we're going to do is we're going to put in 500 calories of whole natural food. It's going to have a bunch of colors to it. It isn't going to just be one thing. We're going to have some salad, and we're going to have some red beans or whatever it is. We're just going to put a bunch of food in there. And what's in that food mostly is going to be fiber. And the reason is that's what most whole natural food is fiber and water, actually. You can look at this, obviously, because pure carbohydrate is, I think, about 1,800 calories a pound, and pure protein is 1,800 calories a pound, and pure fat is 4,000 calories a pound. Yet, whole natural food is 100 calories a pound for lettuce, 200 calories a pound for most vegetables, 300 calories a pound for fruit. If the caloric constituents of food are 1,800, 1,800, and 4,000 calories a pound, and yet the food itself is only 300, 400, 500 calories a pound, it must be that the majority of that food is fiber and water. And that is exactly what it is. So what we do is we put a whole bunch of food in here. We might put like a pound of food in there, and the average calorie density of that food might be 500 calories. So we have some berries at 300 calories a pound, and we've got some potatoes and beans at 500 or 600. On average, we put some food in there, we get 500 calories. And that's just the right amount of food that this guy needed to say, that's all the food that I need for the next several hours, and to hit the satiety mechanism. It stretches out his stomach. The little calorie receptors are in there determining what the fat content is and the protein and the carbohydrate content. And he says, thanks for the 500. I'm all happy. That's just what I needed for my optimum function right now. No problem. Just like every other creature on Earth. Now, our guy right next to him has exactly the same equipment. We put the same calories in there, and he also has the same response. And when he reaches that 500 calories, a little switch will go on in his head, and he'll say, I'm fully satiated. I don't want any more food. And you might say, oh, no, he doesn't. He has a weight problem. That guy's going to keep eating. He's going to keep eating more food. That's why he's got a weight problem. No, it's not. It's not why he has a weight problem. He does not eat past this mechanism. His mechanism works just as well as the other guy's mechanism. There's nothing wrong with him. Now, what's the problem? Problem looks like this. It's actually several problems, but we're going to look at this one. Now what we're going to do is we're going to put some chocolate shake and cheesecake or something like this in the first guy's gut. And what's going to happen is that we're going to put only 500 calories in there, because that's about how much he needs for the next few hours. Except that because it's some chocolate shake and a cheesecake, it's very, very concentrated food. So it's not a big bunch of food now. This isn't a big bunch. It's now a lot smaller because it's about 1,500 calories a pound. But when we put it in there, the stretch receptors aren't going to be as active because it's only about a third as much food. But yet, he still says, thanks for the 500, because he can count up all those calories so effectively because here he's got fat receptors that are going absolutely crazy. They're saying, wow, you just gave us something really, really fatty. Oh, boy, is that a lot of calories. That's about 500 calories we've eaten already. And he's done. He's not interested in having any more food, even though his stomach's only one-third full. He's had enough. Now, problem here is that this fella, when we put the very same 500 calories into his stomach, it only fills at one-third. And his stretch receptors are saying, well, that's not very much food, but I feel a lot of fat in this food. So there's more calories in it than just one-third of that other meal that we had the other day, which would have been what? One-third of 500 would have been about 170 calories. So he says, this isn't 170 calories. It's more than that. I think there's a lot of fat in here. My fat receptors are singing. I think there's about 400 calories here. But you know what? I need 500. So I want another 100 calories. So now he eats another 100 calories. But now he's had 600, not 500. But he thinks he's had 500. And now our guy just systematically overate. Why did that happen? That happened because, as we look in here, we see he doesn't have as many fat receptors. So when we fill his stomach with a really, really high fat food, those receptors can only signal so fast and so long, and they can't pick it up. They're not sensitive enough. Whereas this guy over here has a ton of fat receptors, and so when we throw a super high fat meal in there, he can figure it out. Individual differences. This is one of many individual differences that there are in satiety mechanisms, but this is probably going to be determined to be a very, very important one. The reason why I say that is rat studies have already shown that this predicts, you know, which rats are going to gain a lot of weight on a high-fat diet quite well. So this is telling us a story here that some rats, this guy here, this guy can pick up that calorie density and he can shut down that hunger drive despite the fact that it's very unusually dense food, whereas the other guy can't. This guy's the freak. This guy's normal. That's what you need to understand. Normal would be that you shouldn't be able to pick that up, but some people can. Why? Individual differences in genes. You guys, I believe most of you have probably heard of the great fighter pilot Chuck Yeager. He was a World War II hero, test pilot, first guy to break the sound barrier, etc. Gutsy character. One of the reasons why he survived in World War II is because he had extraordinary vision. I forget what it was, and an optometrist could tell me how this works. It's like 2200 or 220, something like that. Super long distance vision. This was before radar, so he could pick up the Germans. He could see them by sight before they could see him. So he could maneuver out and around them so they'd never see him coming. And for a long time in aviation, it was very important for people to have really good vision. I'm not sure how important it is today, but it's always been an important issue for this kind of early history in the field. It's just genetic difference. Chuck Yeager was better designed for doing fighter pilot work in an environment where there wasn't any radar. Great specimen for that. If it so happens that you're a freak, that you've got all kinds of ability to detect super concentrated calories in a land that's full of them, even though you were never supposed to be in that land, guess what you get to do? You get to eat as much as you want of all the crap you are and not have a body that's out of shape. Good for you. That doesn't mean that you are superb or superior when it comes to your willpower, intelligence, conscientiousness, or anything else. It just means you're unusual. And if it turns out you're struggling with this problem, that you are in fact eating foods that are too concentrated, like everybody is, and you are struggling with the pleasure trap the way everybody does, and you have a normal nervous system that cannot pick up these super concentrated calories and count them effectively, then you're going to wind up with a weight problem. Just like my cat Boo is having a problem right now eating Newman's food. Okay? Now, this is breaking the law of satiety. You can fool the stretch receptors by basically when you put food in there, if you take the fiber and water that was supposed to be in there with the food, we've now shrunken the food and we've got a problem. And now we're going to have to fill more food in there even though we got plenty of calories. that's going to be the number one issue. You can feel the, fool the nutrient receptors by making the very, very concentrated nutrient in the human diet, i.e. fat, by putting it in there at a level that it can't detect it, that there's just not enough sensitivity in the system for the people to pick that up. Most people cannot pick up high concentrations of fat. They will not judge the amount of calories that they ate very well. An experiment at Penn State University showed that if you have two sets of women both eating a bowl of pasta, the pasta's got about 500 calories, I think it was, of pasta and vegetables. So they both got the same amount of pasta and vegetables. It's the same size amount of food that they're going to put in their bodies. The first group is going to eat about 500 calories. They're going to be done. They don't want to eat anymore. The second is going to eat that same 500 calories of vegetables and pasta, and when they finish, they too are going to be done, except that we did something to the second group. We've put a little bit, a couple of tablespoons of oil on there, and that's 300 calories. A tiniest little bit of fluid that we put on there, and it winds up, even though it doesn't change the size of the food, so it doesn't basically alter the stretch receptors at all, those people slurped up the same amount of pasta and vegetables plus 300 extra calories. Do you understand how dramatic that is? That the people over here that didn't have that in there would never eat another 300 calories of pasta and vegetables. That would never happen. That would way go past the stretch receptor and nutrient receptor activity. They're long since done by the time they go to 500 calories. But you can slip in super hyper-concentrated calories very easily, and most nervous systems can't see it. And that is the problem that we have. That, folks, is the number one problem with weight management today, is that people are eating high concentrations of fat and it's slipping past the satiety. So, primary causes of dietary excess is actually fiber deficiency. You've removed all the fiber out of those calories, so it's not corn anymore. It's not even cornmeal. It's corn oil. So we've taken the most calorically dense thing out of that corn, and we've turned it into 4,000-calorie-a-pound food. We put a little bit in our salad or a little bit in our pasta, and suddenly we've got a hyper-concentrated food. We can also damage fiber by the processing of foods. We can actually take that food and make it much, much easier to digest so that the body doesn't have to work as hard, and this is what happens when we do a lot of grinding. So it's very easy for me to eat a lot of bread, but it's not so easy for me to eat a lot of rice. So if I go into a restaurant and there's bread there, it's easy enough for me to eat 3 or 4 pieces of bread, but I wouldn't eat the equivalent amount of rice. Why? Because it's very easy to eat that bread, very soft, easy to digest, etc. And that disturbs the stretch receptors mechanism, because as you put food into the stomach, it's having to work it and stretch out the stomach and work, and the muscles are going to having to work. Whereas if we put it in there that it's where it's been basically pre-digested by steel teeth, when it's been through a processing mechanism, then you don't have as much reception when it comes to the calories that you've eaten. The result is that you can overconsume calories, and you can wind up basically, for all intents and purposes, the diet is artificial. Diet's artificially concentrated, and therefore the satiety mechanisms are doing the best they can, but they're not playing with a fair field. Now, look here at how dramatic that this can get. What's more filling? Pint of ice cream? Super concentrated. Okay, super concentrated food. Bunch of processed sugar, bunch of cream, introduced in Paris in 1677 to rave reviews for the next 300 years. Why? It's banging on every pleasure center in that system as hard as you can go. Very easy to eat, smooth, easy, no fiber, nothing to digest. We just go right into that system, and we can eat a tremendous amount of calories in a very concentrated space. We could do that, or the same amount of calories would be half a gallon of salad, 3 ears of corn, 2 baked potatoes, and a pound of cherries. Same calories. Do you see why it is? Where it's easy enough to overeat? Very easy to overeat. Now, let's look now at calories per pound. This is a very carefully done chart that I did. Here we have salad at 100 calories a pound. Typical vegetables could be a couple hundred calories a pound. Fruit around 3 maybe. grains, starches, beans, potatoes, rice, etc., 500 to 600 calories a pound, the way you're going to eat them with their water content. Up here we have meat at about 1,200 calories a pound typically. Bread and cheese, 1,700 calories a pound. Coca-Cola, for all intents and purposes, is going to be 1,800 calories a pound. Why? Seems like a pound here, it's only got 160 calories in it or whatever. What do you mean, 1,800 calories a pound? The water goes right through you. It's not sitting in your stomach in a digestive process where it's stretching out those stretch receptors and getting credit for that space. Very quickly, the water goes through. It's super easy to digest. An isolated sugar like that, and therefore, for all intents and purposes, it's just pure sugar. And so as a result, what you're seeing there is 1,800 calories a pound. Now, you're only eating a couple ounces. That's why it's only impacting your satiety a little bit. So you're eating a couple of ounces of pure sugar. And so what we're seeing here, these are very concentrated foods. Chips, 2,500 calories a pound, mostly made out of oil with a little bit of vegetable. Chocolate, 3,000. Pure fat oil, 4,000. Look at the enormous difference. This is whole natural foods down here. You're talking about 8 and 10 and 15 times concentrations. So when you have foods that take up a tiny little bit of space but have a whole lot of calories, it's very easy for the system to not be able to read them. And that's our problem. So here's a graph. Stole this graph, I believe, from John McDougall. This is 400 calories of oil, 400 calories of chicken. In other words, a pretty concentrated food, but look at the difference. This is not really artificially concentrated. It's just some of the most dense food in nature. That is artificially concentrated. Here's vegan fare, full of fiber, water, etc. That's the mainstay of the human diet, would be food like that. You see what it does to the gut. Stretches it out, activates satiety, puts the person on a path where they're not going to systematically overeat. Now, the U.S. food consumption, let's figure out the great mystery of the world. Is it bad parenting, the stress that people have in the world today? Of course, it couldn't possibly be stressful to live in an environment with, you know, political turmoil, famine every other year, and you know, disease. That's not stressful. Only the United States is stressful. That's why people are overeating. Okay? No, that's not what's happening. What's happening is what people are putting in their mouth. About half the food is refined carbohydrate and oil. About 42% of the food is dairy and animal foods, super concentrated. All we're getting is a little bit of fiber. And yet, human nature would have been the majority of the calories would have come from highly fibrous materials. So all that's happening, folks, is very, very simple. The food's too concentrated. The problem with weight, if you're overweight now and you're saying, well, what can I eat, Dr. Lyon? What should I do? Well, if you have a weight problem, all I know is that your diet's too concentrated. I don't know, I need to know anything else about you. Okay? And you say, well, what can I do? What if I have this, can I have that? I wouldn't have any idea. Because your genes are unique to you, so I don't know. All I know is we're going to start somewhere, and we're going to take some food that you're eating now and some food that is lower in calorie density, and we're going to swap them. And if we swap them, I know that you're going to lose weight. I don't know how much weight you're going to lose, but you're going to lose some. I had a woman that came to me to get a document signed that so that she could get her gastric bypass surgery. This lady just walked into my office off her insurance plan. Can you imagine walking into my office looking for that? I don't know which of us was more upset. It's like, you came to me for what? No. I said, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to let them cut out your precious organs that have been designed for you to work properly. I'm not going to do it. And you can go right down the street, and there's five psychologists on this street that will be glad to take your money and do this, but I'm not going to do it. I got her intrigued. What do you mean? I said, you just have a dietary content problem. You have a behavior management problem. You don't have a... This is not a problem with your body. There's nothing wrong with your body. Yes, it is. I've tried every diet. Really? You've tried every diet? Ever heard of John McDougall? No. Ever heard of Dean Ornish? No. Ever heard of Colin Campbell? No. Ever heard of Dr. Esselstyn? No. Well, then you haven't heard of this diet. So I spent the next year with this lady who liked me for some reason. I have no idea why, because I was like really honoring. And I'd say, look, I want you to do this. It was one of these things where we get excited where somebody has so much to gain and you want them to do well. And so I was like pushing in a cheerleader, and I said pushing a little too hard, and she just wasn't going to do anything. But she sat right there, not going to, she at least didn't do her surgery. And this went on for about 8 months. And so I tried everything I could think of to maneuver her to get her motivated. And this is a lady that, you know, I don't think knowingly ever ate a vegetable. I mean, this was just, it was McDonald's and ice cream, and I mean, that's just what it was. And ham and eggs for breakfast. And I said, look, okay, one day I said, look, this is all I want you to do. I just want you to make one change. Don't make any other changes, just one. I want you to just eat oatmeal in the morning. And I don't care if you put syrup all over it. I don't care if you put Count Chocula in there. I just want you to eat some oatmeal. She said, okay. She started eating oatmeal. She went down to 260 pounds. She lost 78 pounds. She didn't do anything else. It didn't matter how hard I tried. It didn't matter how slick I was, or, you know, little jokes or encouragement. Or, it didn't matter what. There was no way to get her to move. She said, I got to tell you, Dr. Lyle, that I feel good. I feel good. You know, I when I used to go with my daughter to her things at school, I was like a spectacle. And I was embarrassed, and my daughter was embarrassed. But now I just kind of look like everybody else, and I'm fine with that. Thought, well, fair enough. Okay, we did what we needed to do. We swapped one thing, and that's the effect that we got. And I knew that if we'd swap something else, we'd get more, but I just had to leave it alone. Okay? Now, so you need to be thinking, if you have a weight problem now, what are you going to swap? You just need to swap something. And if you want to get more effect, you're going to swap more. Here's Joel Furman's graph again. Very same story. Now we're going to look at this. This is going to be the summary, basically the summary of the principles. If you have excess fat on a body, what you're going to have is this interaction between the artificially concentrated food and the genes. And that's going to determine what it is that you're going to see. So, for example, if you're eating a very highly concentrated diet, artificial diet with very little fiber and water in it, then if you've got skinny genes, you're going to be a little bit overweight eventually. Not very much. These are the people that don't think they have any problems at all, that their diet's fine. That's until they get a heart attack or cancer. Then they don't know what happened. They need to get medical help. But they have no idea. They don't know that their diet's out of line because they happen to be protected here just by some unusual genes. If you're average and you eat this high-fat diet, you're going to wind up moderately overweight. If you do a better job on the diet and do quite a good job relative to most people, there's more fiber in your diet. You have chicken, fish, and cheese, and pizza, but you have a salad every night and an apple in the morning. Well, that puts you here. It dramatically reduces the concentration, and you're going to have less fat on you than if you're over here. Okay? Now, these people here have much curvier genes. These are women that have curves. They're designed by nature that way to just be, there's natural variation in people. So these are the curvier women or the men that are naturally burly. Now, burly is pretty much the look that I've been going for. You noticed that. I always wanted that look, okay? Now, the thing is that you've seen this in athletes, big, strong, terrific athletes here. The problem is that when they are doing prodigious amounts of exercise in their youth, you know, phenomenal, if they're like professional athletes, they're fine, because they just burn up all those calories in spite of the fact that they're eating huge concentrations. But the thing is over time, have you ever seen when they retire? One of the shames is to watch these guys that were so magnificent. Pretty soon what happens is they're eating this diet and they've got these hefty genes and they're way up here. And boy, is that a sad sight to see, okay? And so if you're a burly male or a curvy lady, what's going to happen is if you eat this diet, eventually that's where you're going to wind up. If you eat this diet, then you start here and you go down to here and then you stop right there, okay? If you eat this diet, and this is what would be maybe a moderately processed diet, this would be, you know, Esselstyn, McDougall, Furman, etc., Goldhammer. Well, Goldhammer's more this direction. But if you have... That's actually true, by the way. Now, it turns out that if you eat a diet down in here where you've got some pasta, a little bit of processed food, you've got some you have a little bit of bread in the diet. You have some amount of concentrated calories, but it's not overwhelming the system. Then people wind up down in these ranges, even these people. Now, I had a woman that was very, very naturally curvy. And she came to the McDougall program real frustrated because she had these genes and she had been eating this diet, so she was up here. And then for the next year, she ate the McDougall diet, which is about here, the standard McDougall diet. And she came down and she landed right there at that last 15 pounds or 20 pounds, and she was irritated. She said, "I have to tell you, I have not been one inch out of line. This is a bright, diligent person that was not going to, you know, she got such benefit, she wasn't going to step out an inch out of line." And she says, "I've been stopped for months. And it's clear I've got too much weight on me. What am I doing wrong?" And the answer is nothing. You're not doing anything wrong. Biochemically, you're probably very healthy, doing really well. But the only problem is that it's a little bit of processing here, a little too much for you, slightly too rich. You've stalled right there. We have to move this direction towards truly whole natural unprocessed food. We have to get rid of the bread and the pasta and some nuts. Okay, we got to like knock off some of the more concentrated things. We did. We took her all the way down to here, and I said, "Look, we're not doing this for life. I just want you to run an experiment. I want you to know what it feels like to get there, and then you're there, and then you can decide from there what it is that you want to do. But I want you to know that this is possible, that you don't have something wrong with you, that you can eat as much as you want, and that's where you'll go." And she did. Over the next 4 months, she lost that last weight and got down to here, and then she called me up, and she said, "I'm having a problem." I said, "Well, what's that?" She said, my adult children now believe that I'm sick because I'm too thin. So now what do I do? Okay? And I said, "Well, then why don't you then split the difference and go about here? And let's add a little pasta in every week and add a little bit of bread. So let's do that." And she did, and then she crept back up there, and there she's happy. Good. Now that's where we go. So wherever you want to be on this line, folks, you can get there. If you want to go all the way to here, fine, go all the way to here. If you don't want to go that far, you go to here. If you want to do a little better, you go to here. If you're just happy going from here to here, fine. Okay? No problem. You choose your place, you go that direction, your body will go that direction, it will take you there. You don't have to consciously regulate this, it will be unconsciously regulated. The question is, why it is are some people hefty and some people skinny, and how would that work? Well, here's one reason. Here's a bunch of people on the edge of Asia, Polynesian area, etc. They're on the mainland, except that this guy over here is taking over, and he's going to stop this guy from being with this girl. And so this guy says, "You and I and our friends, we're going to go on a boat and we're leaving this island because the chief's too mean," and they go. So off they go on the boat, and they go 200 miles looking for a new island to go to. The only problem is some of them don't get there because there's not enough food. So who do you think got to the next island? The curvaceous, burly ones got to the next island. The skinny ones, they ate along the way. Okay. Once they got to the next island, a couple hundred years later, somebody said, "That chief wants my woman. We're going on the boat," etc. They go to the next island. And over the last several thousand years, you see a migration. You get to Hawaii, and what are you going to find in the native people? Burly, curvy, beautiful people. Those burly, curvy, beautiful people, if you feed them a standard American diet, what happens? They get huge. Okay, this is where you're seeing effectively 100% rates of adult onset diabetes in 10-year-olds in Samoa. Okay, what's happening? Those people that are naturally this way because of this natural feast and famine migration across the oceans, i.e. what they have is they all have the burly genes. See? If you happen to be born with burly genes or curvy genes or even moderately curvy genes, I guarantee you, you're struggling with a weight problem. Why? Because you're in modern America and you're in an environment that's designed to make you overweight, sick. Now, so the you don't need to try to eat less. You've got circuits in you. I call them YAL circuits. As soon as you are overweight, what happens is these circuits turn on. They start to create a biochemical concentration in your blood that will tell you to start eating less. So guess what? You don't have to consciously eat less. All you have to do is eat an appropriate calorie-dense diet, and your body will take the weight off by itself. The job is not to consciously eat less. That is not how we lose weight. What we have to consciously do is reduce the concentration of the food down to appropriate levels, and it will take care of itself. That is how you lose weight without losing your mind. Now, how do we get that concentration so it's really appropriate or best? This is what I call my religion of eating. This is a really good way to do this if you're really trying to get on a good track for the new year. For your main meal of the day, which is probably going to be dinner, eat your salad first, your vegetables second, and anything concentrated third. Do it in that order. The salad has the lowest calorie density, so it's the least interesting. So we eat that first when we're hungry. Then we go to the vegetables, which are going to be next level of concentration, or it might be soup, for example. And then whatever you're going to eat for the more concentrated food, the could be pasta, rice, or corn, you know, et cetera, that sort of thing. Any concentrated grain, potatoes, we eat that last because those are about 500 or 600 calories a pound, or beans, for example. If we do that, if we eat them in that order typically, then we're going to make sure we get plenty of salad and vegetables in there, which is a key to having the overall concentration of the diet low enough that you'll be able to lose weight easily. We don't need any other bizarre cockamamie theories about why you've got psychological troubles that are driving this. We don't need that because it's completely unnecessary. In philosophy, we'll call this Occam's razor, that we don't need to add some explanation to the system when it's so easy to see what the cause is. All you have to do for rats is feed them appropriate rat chow, and they will regulate their weight perfectly. But if you throw bread and chocolate in the cage, the average rat will gain 49% of its body weight in 60 days. No problem. The rat didn't go through any trauma. It didn't have his mother issues. There's nothing going on here. All we did was we concentrated the diet above what it was designed to get in nature, and it systematically overate. Some of them overate a lot and doubled their weight. Some of them overate a little and gained a little bit of weight. But it's just a bell curve here, dependent upon their genes. There's no other reason for us to be worried about this problem. Just eat the right food. The reason why this is going to be tough is not because there's anything wrong with you, it's because of the pleasure trap. The pleasure trap is a problem all of us face. Me, other skinny people, people of moderate weight, people of, you know, from all walks of life with all kinds of issues, it doesn't matter what's going on, the pleasure trap's the problem. The pleasure trap drives us towards these concentrated foods, and that's actually what we're facing. The moth will fly into the light, and if it's a candle, it'll kill itself. And sometimes I leave my light on at night, and I come out in the morning, and I see some dead moths on the ground, and it's like, oh, I should have turned it off, okay? What happens? Why are they doing that? Because they're designed by nature to actually seek light, because when they go up in the air, there's the light that they're seeking is the moon. And they use the moon as a guidepost to get up, and then they go search for mates and foods over here, and then they have a reverse compass inside their head. But once they go over there, they fly back up to the moon, and then they fly home. They're built that way. It's their design. So if you put a super light, a big light out on your porch that's 10 times brighter than the moon, what are they going to fly to? They're going to fly to your light, and they're going to hit the glass, and then they're going to stumble, and they're going to fly to hit the glass again and stumble and fly and hit the glass again and stumble. That's what they're going to do. That looks like everybody with a weight problem that I've ever seen. They're flying towards the concentrated food. They stumble if they're in trouble. Okay? This is the cycle. This is the cycle we need to break. Do you need to be perfect? No. You just need to do a real good job. We need to swap out some foods, put more healthy food in, take out some food that's less healthy. But is there room for any indulgence? Of course there is. You're designed by nature to be able to manage some concentrated food in the diet. And our ancestors would have had those, and they would have managed their weight fine. We just can't make it a major component the way it is now. For myself, I've got my own little issues here. Like this here is carrot cake. Now, let me tell you the story about carrot cake. I went years without eating carrot cake, and when I wrote The Pleasure Trap with Dr. Alan Goldhammer, who is perfect, by the way, it's really annoying that that's true. There was a little place near our office where I'd always go for lunch, and I would eat a thing called a vegan wrap, obviously. And then one day after the Pleasure Trap had been published, I thought to myself, what am I doing being so perfect? I don't need to be so perfect. For crying out loud, what are we going to make a contest out of this? Forget it. They've got that carrot cake. I've been looking at that carrot cake for 3 years. I'm going to have a piece of that carrot cake. So I had a piece of the carrot cake, and then, you know, I had heard about Colin Campbell's work with dairy products, and I'd read John McDougall's book, so I knew I don't eat the dairy frosting, so scrape the frosting off and eat the carrot cake. It was not too bad. So the next time I went in there, I ordered another vegan wrap and another piece of carrot cake. And these people all know me because I go there all the time. So I went back the next day, ordered another vegan wrap, another piece of carrot cake, another vegan wrap, another piece of carrot cake. I did this for about a couple months, and I had probably 25 vegan wraps, 25 pieces of carrot cake. Then I went away to speak with Alan about the pleasure trap and came back and called his wife on the phone. He said, what are we going to have for dinner? She says, I'm too late. It's too late. You guys are in too late. Why don't you guys go get something to eat? And Alan says, well, gosh, we're right by the Redwood Cafe. Why don't we go over there? It's where I made my mistake. I had right then is when I should have said something. But I said, okay. So we go to the Redwood Cafe, and I'm walking in there, and I'm thinking, I'm going to go right up to that gal, and I'm going to order really fast, and I'm going to make it really clear. So I went up to her, and I said, I'm just having a vegan wrap. She says, and a piece of carrot cake? And I said, no, just a vegan wrap. And she said, are you sure? That's what Alan looks like all the time. That's the McDougall medallion around his neck. McDougall medallion, you get in a secret ceremony if it appears that you are perfect and you're going to live to 105. I don't have one of those, but that's who he is. Now, there's two programs that I like that I told you about before. This is the McDougall program. There's a pool and trees and John and Mary and everybody's happy and everything's great. John McDougall is the warden for the McDougall jail, and it's a really nice jail and very pleasant. Here's the warden for Allen's jail. It's just how he looks, just like that. Folks, you don't have to be perfect to solve this problem. You don't have to discover extraordinary conscientiousness. You don't have to completely change your life. You don't have to override your hunger drive or your instincts. All you have to do is do the same battle that anybody that's seeking health has to do. It is a difficult battle. It's a hard battle. It's one that you won't simply win one day and then never have to look over your shoulder. It's one that we're all looking over our shoulder. We're always struggling a little bit with this, but if you get on a healthy roll, if you make enough of these trades so that you're habitually eating a lot of healthy food, that it becomes the mainstay of your diet, if that happens, you're going to find that your weight is going to regulate well. If it's not well enough for you, then we just have to tweak it a little bit more and go a little bit more towards more natural foods until it does. But you're not destined to have weight problems. You weren't designed with it. There's nothing wrong with your body, and there's nothing wrong with your mind. All you need to do is treat this this gift that we have called life in a way that it was designed to be treated. And if we do that, and we do a good job at this, even though it's not perfect, you can have the life that you deserve. Thank you very much for coming. It's been a pleasure. Pleasure. Pleasure's mine. Thank you.
Does anyone have a question for Dr. Lyle? Yes.
Hi, Dr. Lyle. So I'm one of those people that struggles, but I have a very healthy diet. I've worked with AJ for a couple years now. So let's say I'm doing a smoothie in the morning, like the green smoothie. Would I be better off actually eating the whole components of that versus blending them then?
Good question. The question is green smoothie in the morning, which apparently all the way from Dr. Esselstyn to here is becoming the controversy of the vegan world. That green smoothie is not a concentrated food, so this is not something I'm worried about. That would be the last thing that I would be worried about. I would be looking elsewhere in your diet for where there's some food that's that's maybe a bit too concentrated. There's might be something slipping in on the side somewhere. Those, even a little tiny slip somewhere, can be vastly more important than what would be happening with that green smoothie. So let's look for other places for a little bit of too much concentrated food first, and let's make that swap, okay, and worry about that last. Very good question. Okay, yes.
Hi, Dr. Lyle.
Hi,
my name's Alyssa. This is really cool. I don't know how I never heard the second part of your talk before. About the genetics you explained about the more burly people or like the curvy women,
yes.
Does that mean the receptors where you store fat or your bones? What does that mean exactly?
Actually, what this means is that the that people, if you were to draw a bell curve of when the average person becomes satiated with respect to their food, you're going to find that throughout nature, including humans, it's going to be right on perfect. In other words, the average person is going to know if we feed it, if we feed them a diet that's appropriate to their nature, they're going to nail this thing. They're going to be perfect their whole lifetime. Now, as we move to the sides of the bell curve, there's going to be people that are going to actually possibly undereat a little bit, and they're going to have to be more active. They're going to get very, very slender. Okay, so they're not going to that side of the bell curve is going to be in such a way that they're not going to they're typically not going to systematically undereat unless we make that food unusually unconcentrated. And this is what will sometimes happen with people that switch to raw food diets, that the raw food diets are sometimes very low in terms of caloric density, and they take a lot of energy for digestion. And so some people will actually start systematically undereating, and they'll actually get too thin for optimal. They're still quite healthy, but they're not as healthy as they could be. Now, the other side of the bell curve is the one where almost all the problems are. And that is when people that are on the other side of the curve, if they were to eat a diet that's a little bit concentrated, they start putting on weight. Why that happens is probably is the result of several mechanisms. It's not one. Okay, it's probably going to have individual differences in stress receptor sensitivity, nutrient receptor sensitivity, feedback mechanisms to the hypothalamus from leptin. It's going to be all kinds of things, and it probably won't be charted out for another 15 years. We do know that it's there. You can see it as simply as with a group of rats that is all in perfect condition, and then we throw the bread and chocolate in the cage, and suddenly we get a nice bell curve. Some of them are fine, and then to varying degrees, the rest of them are having weight problems. Some of them are having extreme weight problems, but all of them are having significant weight problems, but some of them are having almost no weight problem. That's the genetic variation that we're seeing when we make a radical environment change, and that's exactly what you're seeing today in the United States. Radical environment change in the last 50 years has left the middle of the bell curve lost and in trouble, i.e. 30, 40, 50 pounds overweight. It's left some people 60, 80, 100, or 150 pounds overweight, and it's left a few people almost not overweight because they're unusual. Okay? That's how that works. Thank you. You bet.
And thank you so much, Dr.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you.